We don't have to preach to the converted. All of us sitting here, we want a new India. We want a different kind of politics. And we want to bear the burden and pay the price to make it happen. So we don't have to really talk about that. So I talk essentially about two things today. The first is there realistic hope that what we are dreaming will actually happen? Is it worthwhile fighting for this? Last night, an independent journalist spent time with him in Vietnam. He said, you know, sir, what they say is all right, but we are all sitting here. We have seen the world, we have seen politics, we have seen monumental corruption, we have seen the kind of money being spent by the candidates, the kind of money being made by the independent fellows. We have seen the way people are not really bothered too much about it beyond a point. So, all this is nice, but there are many experienced, eminent people here. Many of you have spent a lifetime serving the public cause. People like Mr. Mukherjee, Mr. Namaka, and many other people. You know a lot about human nature, our society, this city, and the state of Karnataka. My appeal is, often when we look at things, we see it as a still picture. We think things are not changing. That's not true. Life is a motion picture. I remember as a kid in a village, we had to persuade the farmers to accept chemical fertilizers. I remember as a young boy, arguing with the farmers saying that, look, unless you apply fertilizers, the yields will not go up. I remember farmers arguing, no, it's not good. We must only have organic manure. Similarly, pesticides. Today, when you go and tell them, look, too much of application of fertilizer or pesticide is not a good thing. Let us do it differently. Again, it's very hard to communicate. But over the past 30, 40 years, things have changed dramatically. It didn't change one day. It changed over a period of time. When you look at other countries, let us say the common examples that come to our mind because they're already speaking, or United States, many of you, your family, friends in those countries, you visited those countries, and you compare with those countries and say, look, how terrible things are around us. But believe me, those countries did not see change in one day. It took decades, sometimes generations to change. Many of you have seen the Lincoln film. What is all the film about? 10% of all the able-bodied Americans had to die in order to fight for a simple principle that the black man cannot be enslaved. And Lincoln had to do a lot of good things and bad things in order to amend the Constitution to say that slavery is for everyone. But today it appears very simple. But it was so difficult then. When you look back, it's ridiculous that you have to fight a civil war to establish the fellow human beings and all states. Now we think that look, they have a civilized society. We want to talk about this. Britain similarly has seen so many problems. It took years and decades to change things. If you take America, the presidential debates, which I'm sure most of us enjoy, between Obama and Mitt Romney, it took 20 or 25 years for the debates to become a part of American politics, even after television became very popular. It did not happen only. Today we see in a mature form, we say, why don't we have an Indian? Why are people shouting and fighting at each other? Why are they abusing each other? Why are they not simply discussing and debating issues? Forgetting that it took a generation for that to happen in that fashion. Take the Industrial Revolution. We all study in our textbooks and we teach our children that because of new technology, because of steel mill, because of many other things that came up. Britain revolutionized itself and the world. But let us pause for a moment and look at what exactly was the revolution. Do you know that the growth rate in the industrial revolution in Britain for about 100 years or 70 or 80 years, you know what the growth rate was? It was just 1% annual economic growth. A 1% growth rate was a revolution. Because for centuries, there was a stagnant economy which was 0%. And if a 1% economy meant for 50 or so years, the GDP would double. In 100 years, it would actually quadruple. It was a miracle. Because it never happened in human history. In a century, the wealth never became four times in a century. Now today in India, if the growth rate is 5 or 6%, we are depressed. We are saying anything less than 8 or 9% means our children's dreams cannot be fulfilled. So my appeal to all the deeply concerned, committed, educated, enlightened middle class Indians and Bangaloreans is, please do not ever think that other societies will be very fast or much better than us. No. We are forgetting that there is a process at work. Sometimes in an hour, in a day, it appears to be hopeless and peculiar. But in reality, significant changes are taking place. We have to put it together. We have to find those levers to accelerate this pace of change. And moments come when you can accelerate it much better than other times. Now is the moment of phenomenon. This state is much more ready than any other state of India for a variety of reasons you all know. For embracing new kind of politics, for bringing the disenfranchised, disgruntled middle classes and educated classes back into the political stream and leadership, for changing the tenor of politics. This time in Bangalore, there is really an opportunity to see quite a few of our legislators, quite a few of our leaders, sitting in the Vidhan Sabha and making a difference. And please do not think for a moment, what will Dr. Meenakshi alone do if she goes to that center? After all, the other 223 people will not cooperate. How will you do somebody else? Surely they will not get power. We are not contesting everywhere. So what is the purpose? I want you to believe in all your hearts that one person with conviction is a majority. Those of you who are familiar with Andhra Pradesh, you would realize the numbers of this Congress and the PDP and the others. But when the lone member of Loksatta Party stands in assembly, the whole house listens to pin drop silence. When they wanted to bring in a terrible law, it was this feeble voice of one person that stopped them. They did not dare to bring it before the assembly again. It did not happen as long as I can. One person can take it. See, if you know what we are fighting for and how we fight, if you know how to fight, they are not enemies. If you know how to fight this battle in a practical way, in a skillful way, with conviction and commitment, you can make a difference. And the Andhra Telangana issue, there was a problem. I don't want to go to taking that stuff. There was a presidential order, there was a document about police recruitment that needed change. It was this lone voice which said, look, we must now resolve unanimously that this provision 14 years must be repealed. All parties opposed. Not only because those are the subjects must be done in this state for the sake of the state. The people of Telangana must feel that there are stakes in this state. Eventually, everybody agreed with unanimously the constitution and approved by the president. Krishna faced it as we call it. The government came on. Again, this lone voice made it possible for Krishna faced it to happen. Now the president and executive by the end of this year, we will have a military order of the capacity from the Krishna. I can go on now, local to global issues. One voice, if the moral power, intellectual power, is skillfully harnessed, If we know how to work with other parties, do not have animosity in our heart. We do not treat them as enemies, but we, without compromising our principles, know how to negotiate, because all the parties are about negotiation. It's about skillful, principled negotiation to arrive at a decent compromise. I truly believe that there is a realistic chance of several members of the Loksatta going to the legislature and Bangalore City alone in 2013 elections. And with these very highly accomplished, committed people, we can actually change the trajectory of politics and trajectory of policies for Bangalore City and the Karnataka. We all must understand that and believe. If really all that requires 113 members of the assembly, well, BJP did manage 113 members. Where is BJP now? Congress did manage earlier, but where is Congress now? And even if they get into power each of these parties, what are they doing? Are they happy with themselves? Are we happy with them? Therefore, let us not worry about how many numbers we have. If we know what we want, oftentimes we don't know what we want. Oftentimes we don't know how to get it. If you know what you want, if you know how to get it, even a few members will change the politics of Karnataka eventually, the politics and public life of India. There's a wonderful teacher here, Mrs. Jyoti Jagrat. Is Jyoti teaching? She's kept out. She's now working to improve the education outcomes in this country. You know, there is a survey called PISA survey. Program of International Student Assessment. 15-year-olds are surveyed to measure the educational outcomes in schools. In 74 countries, they conducted this survey. For the first time, America is the only rich country surveyed by OECD. Now the included countries are India, 74 countries are India. Do you know India's rank is 73rd? All our children, we all know our children. We want them to get good education. There is not a family, including that of a owner, or a lecturer, or an education person, or a wealthy man. There is not a family who does not want good education for its children in this country, even if it is sacrificed to make. But the sad truth is, in most cases, when we have been working hard, sacrificing a great deal, our children are getting third-rate education. They are right. We are coming. But education in most cases is third rate. But we can easily change it because demand is very strong and our children are right. And if we know how to leverage our strengths, how to measure outcomes and make the parents realize that we are a short game and short change, we can easily get better outcomes for our children. India will be easily in the top 10 within 3 years. But for that, some people must work systematically with understanding and help. Our true politics is about that. A Barack Obama talks about how to improve the educational scores. A George Bush Jr. became president only because in the state of Texas, he improved the educational scores. The only claim to fame George Bush Jr. had before becoming president was, I improved educational outcomes in Texas state schools. That's all. He became president. As President Barack Obama talks about education outcomes every day, Cameron talks about how important it is to give the British children education. His predecessor, Tony Blair, was EEC chairperson. He gave a speech, inaugural speech as chairperson of EEC. He said, countries like India are forging ahead, they are taking care of our children's jobs. We must focus on education and see that our children retain those jobs and competitiveness. Have you ever heard an MLA or an MP or a minister or a chief minister or a prime minister of India make a speech like that in this country? Look, our children must get decent education to be able to forge ahead in the modern world. That is politics. Politics is not that of someone in my mind. Politics is not the deal of power. Politics is not the Dharam Singh. Politics is not Jagan. Politics is not another. Politics is not about matter. Politics is about how we improve the school outcomes. And for that, there are ways of doing things as legislators, as citizens, as governments, as bureaucrats. We have forgotten what really matters in life. What Loksatta is doing is not something very great and profound and novel, something practical and simple. Dr. Meenakshi has been fighting to get a proper Dalit place. Ramakant Sahab has not only worked in Bangalore, he came to Hyderabad, sat with all people, tried to inspire people to improve. The other day he came to himself, J.P. Sahab, I came to Hyderabad, nothing much has happened in this. Okay. That is how things change. That is politics. Unless we redefine politics, unless we understand what is it that we really need, is it that we really need only 130 members in the assembly and becoming part of the plunder, or do we want to influence the way things are done and use the government's money power and the legal power and infrastructure to actually make the right kind of outcomes possible? What is our definition of politics? Is it all about power without purpose? Or is it with purpose? You may get power, you may not get power, but you say influence and bring about changes and damage the standards of the team because it's our children's standard. This practical approach to politics is what is important. You have fantastic leaders in Bangalore City. Dr. Meenakshi Bharath is a great example. These are not people who require to pass the assembly. Frankly, for most of these people, it's infrared to go to assembly and to face humiliation from all kinds of people. To go and answer every person because they try to vote for you, what is happening to them, garbage? Why is the state rate not functioning? This is the kind of question you face. Believe me, Dr. Meenakshi, once you're elected, you actually think, my God, why am I elected? I wish I were upset. It is hell. People are very demanding because you are the only person they can ask. Because they vote it. They don't dare to vote it. You don't dare to vote it. Anyone who is in the corporation asks because you're scared of democracy. You're a Jayaprakash Narayan. He's a frightening fellow. He doesn't listen. Whereas you got the vote, you have to listen. Every person, every day, almost humiliated. I know. I am physically. But we are willing to do that not because we need it, but because we have to bear that burden. But because we have to show a different way. We cannot go on complaining. We actually have a difference today with the fractured politics of Karnataka, with a complete degeneration. With disgust that is felt in this city and most parts of the state. And with the kind of electorate we have in Bangalore city, truly cosmopolitan city, which is a symbol of the new economy and a new society. If you cannot do it in Bangalore, you cannot do it easily elsewhere. This is a priceless opportunity. I am not saying India is going to take tomorrow electoral, everybody writes it is going to be elected. If I say that, I am a fool. I know enough about this country by now, though many of you are far more experienced. But I am saying this is surely going to happen in the next 2 years, the time is right. It will not happen if you don't sit back and listen to Japan. Do you understand Japan? Japan?
Yes.
Chanting, or invoking mantras, or doing a, what do you call it?
Puja. Homa.
It will not happen. It will happen only when we assiduously work for a purpose, smart, intelligent, with a design, with a strategy. And whatever levers are there, we improve Bangalore transport, improve Bangalore education, improve Bangalore water traffic disposal, get slightly better outcomes, get a semi standard income, get a second order income, make it more institutionalized. It is step by step. By the time you realize that 10-15 years is the massive change. One day, nothing appears to change. Because there is no one single solution. There is no one book or this world will transform into a sentence. You require 100 things. Each of them is necessary. We must believe in all our hearts. We must believe in the good sense of our fellow human beings. Not because they are great saints, but because they are practical human beings who want something better for themselves and their families. Only two, three last points. Ultimately, all politics is good because we are all eminent citizens, we are all promoted people. We are discussing this, but this is not what we are talking about. People, at the grassroots level, are not bothered about this. They say, look, will my garbage be clear? Will my streets be better? Will my water supply not be contaminated by sewage? Will the traffic be better? They are not even today asking, will my kid get a better school, better education? Unfortunately, because you don't know what to do. Now, we have to make the thing a little more. Will my kid get better education? Just because I'm poor or my very right kid should not be denied a chance. Will I get proper health care? If I go to the police station, will my voice be heard? Or will the rich man have often done all this in the way? Will my child be safe on the streets of Bangalore? These are the things that are all. It is for us as communicators to link the grand work that we have with the day-to-day concerns that the citizens have. Not only that, everywhere in the world, politics is not about grand issues. That is for the leaders to figure out. The world is not a grand issue. The world is in smaller things. And most of all, in our country, people want you to deliver the work. And they were waiting because they gave it the world. You must somehow deliver it. You must give confidence to them that yes, we will do whatever it takes to deliver somehow. In a sensible democracy, that's not the job of the people. But we are not a sensible democracy at this point of time. And therefore we cannot say, no, no, this is not our job. We must give confidence that yes, we will do more than anybody else, and smartly, more smart than others, to get these things done. And that's why we have such effective leaders, people who work for a lifetime for the cause of public good in this city. These are not green ones who are coming today saying, look, we have some great knights and white horses now. These are people who actually, without having any responsibility except the citizens, they can have themselves to make change possible. The young people, the senior people, the professionals, the students. And therefore, we have the moral authority to tell the people to trust us. Trust us on the basis of our actions, not on the basis of our words. It is this confidence that must be given. And the last point, a friend here from, I think, Bihar himself, much appreciated. He asked me, sir, IASC and Aam Aadmi Party, they also did something similar. Will you all work together? Will you all break up? It is our endeavor to work together. It actually means for God to just be one. If there are some issues where there are two different approaches, we may not be working together, but we must help each other. At the very least, we must not hurt each other. In this city, Aam Aadmi Party has come forward to say as of now that we will do whatever we can to support. Similarly, we will do whatever we can to support now. But the reason why at this point in time we require a different platform and all that form created a long ago is something slightly different. Honesty is the minimum requirement in public life. But it is not the maximum qualification. What is the kind of vision we have for the country? What kind of India do we want to build? We want an India where the international crisis of petroleum products are going up. You want the budget money, the tax money to go to subsidize petrol. And the country having all the money for education, healthcare, infrastructure.